Testing. Hello. Testing.
Good morning, everybody. Are we excited to worship today? Amen. I'm excited as well. Thank you for being here today. We are here, you know, to worship God. And I just want us to be reminded that we're here for one purpose, right? Not to, I mean, yes, we're here to see each other as well, but we're here to give praises and give Him all the glory and all the honor. I mean, through the week that we've been working so hard, we're here to just, you know, lay out everything to Him, give Him thanks. So, Father God, today, God, we recall Your faithfulness. God, thank You for that You walk with us each and every day, and that You are with us each moment. God, we thank You that Your promises are true and Your goodness never fails us. God, right now, today, we come to You and we lay our lives before You. God, we lay out all our burdens and hindrances from truly worshiping You today, God. And God, may we worship and adore You with all that we have. God, may everything within us cry, "Holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who is, who was, and is to come." And God, today, we confess that You are our Lord, that we worship You, Jesus. Jesus, we thank You for this wonderful morning. We adore You and we love You. And in Your name we pray, amen. Amen. Let's all rise as we worship.
Worthy is the King who conquered the grave.
lurking in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. Stop, you never.
Believe that that's who he is, a miracle worker, promise keeper, your light in the darkness. Hallelujah. Isn't it good to know that we have a God who is working? He don't slumber. He's working. He's working in the lives of his people. Early this morning, I sent you a text. VICC family and my friends, that our God, our good God, is the potter. We are just the clay. He is working and still working and working mightily in our midst, in our lives. He never changed. He is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. There's nothing impossible with him. There's nothing too hard for him. Let us be seated and let's stay in the presence of the Lord. God is with us. Let's bow our heads, let's close our eyes, and let us enjoy this moment. This is God's moment with you and our moment with him. Let's bow our heads, close our eyes, and let's just allow him to just fill us with his love and fill us with his presence. Let's allow him to fill us with his grace and mercy and acceptance. Even we failed him so much, or we have disobeyed him in some other ways, but his grace is abundant. Allow him to embrace you. Allow him to say to you and listen to him saying, my child, I love you and I care for you. And I know what you are going through, and I know it's hard. I know you're hurting, but I'm here for you. I once experienced the pain that you are experiencing. I once experienced the heartaches, the rejection that you're experiencing today. Jesus is telling you, I'll experience those. I know what you are feeling, but I'm here for you because I love you. I know your struggles. I know your fears. I know your heartaches. I'm here for you. My child, come to me. And even all of you who are weary and heavy laden, come to me and I will give you rest. For my burden is easy and my The yoke is easy and my burden is light. Come to me. Oh Jesus, we come to you as a church and as individual. Lord, we come to you. Because you alone, our hope, you alone, our light in the darkness, you alone is the miracle worker. You alone that keeps a promise. Our friends, maybe our loved ones have broken their promises, but you will never break your promise to us. You are at work in us and for us to fulfill your promises in our lives. And so we come to you, we lay our lives to you, we surrender our lives to you, we commit our lives to you, because you alone our hope. We try to put our hope on something else, on people, on things. God, we realize that there's only one that is steady and strong and unshakable and unstoppable, and that is you. That is why we put everything in your hand right now. All our worries and all our cares and all our pains, all our expectations, even our sicknesses, even our illnesses, we lay it all down to you. God, we pray as a church for our loved ones and friends out there who are suffering with this pandemic, and with that, even the economic crisis that they're experiencing, and the fears that they have, and the displacement of some families and children, and the fear out there, and even, Lord, the situation of our nation and the world. And as a church, we come to you and intercede, Lord, in behalf of our nation, in behalf of our world, Lord. We pray that God may, you will reconcile back the world to yourself through your Son, Jesus Christ. We intercede. We stand in the gap. We pray for the salvation, Lord, of our unsaved loved ones. We pray for peace. We pray, Lord, for healing for our land and for our world. We pray, God, for righteousness to be restored in our nation, righteousness in our halls of justice, and righteousness in our Senate, in our House of Representatives, and even in the White House and all the halls of justices in the world. We pray, Lord, for the restoration of your righteousness. Even when other religious leaders would say that wrong is right, Lord, we stand in your word that your word is right. It will never be wrong, and the wrong in this world will never be right. And as your people, we stand in what is right. And so we vote this coming November 3. We vote for what is right. We exercise our right of suffrage and vote for what is right. Do our part. Lord, thank you. Thank you for how you will continue, Lord, to sustain your people even in the midst of all this. We have seen your hands working mightily, even if sometimes we don't feel it and sometimes we don't see it, but we know you are working for what is right and good for your people. All we need to do is just to believe that you are at work. Indeed you are. Hallelujah. Can we sing that chorus again? Hallelujah. Let's sing together. Let's declare it.
Waymaker, miracle, yes, Lord. Promise keep, I in the dark.
Declare it. Declare who Jesus is to you. When you're declaring in your life, you will do it.
Promise keep, hide in the darkness, my God. That is who you are. You are.
Yes, God. Are you blessed today? Those of us online, live streaming, stay with us. The Lord is with you there, and the Lord has something for you and for all of us today. We believe that He is working. Amen. He is indeed working in our midst. Praise God. Hallelujah. Today, we will continue our study on the book of Proverbs, our series. And, you know, the title of our series is Clarity in the Midst of Uncertainty. And we know that even before the pandemic hit us, there's already a lot of uncertainty. Because we all know that there's only one that's certain, and that is the Word of God. Amen? God Himself. In this life, in this world, everything is just so uncertain, unstable, shaky. And we know as God's people, there's only one that is steady and strong and unshakable, and that is the Word of God, His promises. Amen? Amen? And as God's people, I'm so blessed. I know you're so blessed also that we are standing on a solid foundation, and that is His Word. And in this time of uncertainty, we need a clear instruction. Again, I say this all the time, almost every Sunday, and Pastor Joey always mentioned this, that clarity or wisdom comes from the Word of God. And so today we are on the sixth chapter. Okay, so open your Bibles there, your Bible apps there. Okay, and Proverbs chapter 6. It's a long chapter. So, fasten your seatbelt, it's gonna be long. So the title of God's word for all of us today is the pitfalls of the undisciplined. Now, this is good. This is good because God would like us to avoid a lot of stuff in this world and in this life that would destroy us, that would derail us, that would, you know, put us in a disadvantaged situation. He wants to bless us. Remember this, God's plan for you, for your future, is always good, and that for your good and for your good future and all that, God promised that for those who will listen and follow Him and follow His wisdom. This chapter, chapter 6, is divided into four sections, actually. 1, 2, 3, 4. The fourth section there is about adultery. It's about marriage. And I will not talk about that anymore because we had so much on that last Sunday, okay? And we enjoyed God's word last Sunday. Pastor Joey you know, talked about that. So I will not, it's actually the same as in chapter 5, warning against adultery. And so I will be talking about verses 1 to 19, and it's divided into three sections. And I will tell you in a little while about that. Okay? Someone said this. Next slide, please. There are three types of people in the world. Three types of people in the world. Those who do not know what is happening. Those who watch what is happening. And those who make things happen. Which are you? Which do you enjoy? You enjoy watching things happening? Do you enjoy not knowing what's going on, or you enjoy making things happen? Wisdom loves to make things happen. Wise people make things happen. Wise people take initiative. Wise people make diligent initiative. Wise people see a problem or a challenge and then act on it. Wise people are part of the solution, not part of the problem. And we hear this over and over again from our, you know, political leaders, you know, be part of the solution, wear your mask, you know. Do this and do that, social distance, don't go to crowded areas. Please be part of the solution, don't be part of the problem. And I guess all of us today are part of the solution, amen? Because I see you're wearing masks. Wise people are not part of the problem, but they're part of the solution. Wise people don't just sit passively and wait for opportunities to come. Wise people prayerfully take actions. They make things happen. Wise people that don't just watch and wondering what's going on. Wise people, when faced with a challenge or a need, the wise person goes to God right away and seek God's wisdom and begin to consider his or her options. What should I do, Lord? I am faced with a challenge. A wise person first, before going to his wife or husband or children or friend or pastor, first has to go to the Lord and ask God, what would you want me to do? Have you heard about a tagline that many Christians or even the radio are saying? WWJD. This sounds familiar, right? What would Jesus do? WWJD. We see that in, you know, some decorations or whatever. But you know what? I find that tagline very, an understatement. It sounds, I think of it differently. What would Jesus do? Because Jesus will do what he wants to do. And many times we don't know what he will do, but he does what he loves to do. It's not my business to ask what would Jesus do in a certain situation. Rather, it's my business to ask what would Jesus have me to do? Because Jesus will do what he loves to do or what he wants to do in a certain situation. But I think the most important question is to ask myself, God, this is the situation. What would you want me to do in response to this? We'll be talking about at least three sections here in the scripture, in the text that we are to discuss. So open your Bibles there, because we are going to look at it verse by verse as we go along. All right? And then see what the Holy Spirit, what the Father and Jesus has prepared for us. So, in verses 1 through actually 5, we have this in our PowerPoint. Let's read it all together. My son, if you become surety for your friend, if you have shaken hands in pledge for a stranger, you are snared by the words of your mouth. You are taken by the words of your mouth. So do this, my son, and deliver yourself. For you have come into the hand of your friend. Go and humble yourself. Plead with your friend. Give no sleep to your eyes, nor slumber to your eyelids. Deliver yourself like a gazelle from the hand of the hunter, and like a bird from the hand of the fowler. Number one point is that the pitfall of the undisciplined is pledging yourself for a stranger, or making yourself a surety to a stranger, to someone that you don't know. In this verse, one word that we are going to look at is the word surety. The word surety is used here. Now, Merriam and Webster's dictionary defines surety as one that is bound with and for another. You make yourself bound with someone with a promise. One who enters into a bond for another's appearance, like in court, or a payment for his debt. One who, in case of the principal debtor's failure, is compelled to pay the debt or damages, a bondsman or a bail. Sounds familiar? In our times, it's called what? Copay. Cosigning. All right. It's called a cosigner. In other words, you can replace the word surety there. My son, if you become a cosigner for your friend or a stranger. There's a warning here. Okay. In other words, if the borrower is not able or does not pay, the cosigner becomes accountable for the debt. We all know that. All right. Now, let me tell you this. Cosigning for another person is not evil in itself. But here, we are warned by wisdom, by the Word of God, about doing that. In other words, He warned us that we've got to be, or that we have to be, good stewards of our resources to enter such an agreement. We have to be careful and think about it and pray about it. It's not evil in itself, but you have to really consider your options and pray more about it. Remember that when you co-sign on a loan, you become obligated for it. We have done this before, many of us probably, because of a friend, someone, or a family member needs it, then we just do it. And probably some of you were in trouble because of that. And probably some are... You're okay. Remember, when you co-sign on a loan, you are obligated for it. But remember that the key word here is the word stranger. Stranger. Would you co-sign on somebody that you don't know? Would you make yourself a surety for some, for a stranger? You would you like go up to somebody and say, hey, let me, you know, promise your debtor that I will do it if you fail to do it? You don't do that. So the word, the key word here is the word stranger. All right? Now this is the point of wisdom. These verses are not a rebuke against generosity. This is not a rebuke for someone who wants to help. All right? This does not mean that you don't need to help or you don't have to be a generous person. But this warning is against overextending one's financial resources and acting in irresponsible ways that could lead to deeper trouble. Remember, it's a warning. It does not say you don't have to. But you have to consider your options. You've got to be wise. That's why we are talking about wise counsel here. Okay? So it is more on telling us that we must not overextend our financial responsibilities because we might be in deep trouble in this matter, financial trouble, or even deep into poverty. Because God loves us. He don't want us to suffer much in this area in our life. Next slide, please. I want you to take this in serious consideration. It is important to maintain a balance between generosity and good stewardship. It does not encourage you not to be generous, but a good balance in generosity and good stewardship. God wants us to help our friends and the needy. All right? But He does not promise to cover the cost of every unwise commitment we make. Unwise. That is why this is a pitfall for the undisciplined. If you are undisciplined in the area of finances, then you will be in trouble. He does not promise to cover every unwise commitment that we make. We should also act responsibly so that our families, ourselves, will not suffer later. All right? But God is a generous God, and He wanted us to imitate Him, to be generous, to be helpful. Don't you think the Good Samaritan overextended his finances? I don't think so. He was a businessman. He brought the guy to the hotel and paid everything. Then we didn't hear anything about that guy anymore after that. All right? And that gives me a conclusion that he's fine. He was generous, but he was a good steward of his resources. There are many things we can actually learn from this wisdom that the Lord has showed us today. And so that's the first part there that I would like us to understand, all right, in a brief way to explain this one. Number two is in verses 6 to 11. Let's read it all together, please. Here, He's giving us a lesson that we should not give in to the temptation of laziness. So, co-signing and then jump to giving in to the temptation of laziness. So, this is what the word says. Go to the end. You sluggard. In some of your translation, slothful. Sluggard. Slothful. My tongue is twisting. Even to say that. Sloth. S-L-O-T-H. Consider her ways and be wise. Observe the ant and be wise. Having no captain, overseer, or ruler, provides her supplies in the summer and gathers her food in the harvest. How long will you slumber, O sluggard? When will you rise from your sleep? He's talking about the lazy man. A little sleep, a little slumber, a little snoring, a little folding of the hands to sleep. So shall your poverty come on, you like a prowler, and your need like an armed man. There are many things we can learn from the natural world. In fact, some of you are familiar about your ancestors, your forefathers. You know, in my experience in the Philippines, we don't have much, they don't have much of the technology of today, and so they just predict some, you know, some weather forecasts or you know, just by looking at the stars and the moon, and they would, you know, even be guided. Their lifestyle are guided by what's going on in the natural world. They would say, oh, the birds are singing. There's earthquake coming. They would say, oh, the moon is red. Oh, somebody died somewhere. Crazy. But you know, they survive life, and even their compass, the direction going north or south, they just, you know, probably feel the wind, where the wind is blowing, or where the sun is setting. And so, the natural world teaches a lot. But for wisdom's sake, an ant, the cutest, or not the cutest, the smallest creature, tiniest creature that you can see. And the Word of God even teaches us to consider the ant. I think it's the reverse. The ant should learn from us. I think we are wiser than the ants. But hey, wisdom is calling us to look at them and consider the ant in the area of discipline. Because we will fall into trouble if we don't follow the instructions of wisdom. So we now turn to one of them. That's the ant. There is wisdom in the way the ant behaves. In fact, the Bible says it has no ruler, yet it just does not sit back and do nothing. It gathers food for its own supply. Nobody commands them. Nobody guides them. When and where and how. They just do what they need to do. It does not depend on others, although they come together and gather in one bin, whatever they can find somewhere. But they don't really depend on others. They sure store what they can gather in a common place. The ant pulls its own weight. Nobody carries them. They contribute to their own welfare. Have you seen an ant sleeping? I think they're all working all the time, right? Busy. There's no sleeping on the job, but working to see that every need is met, especially when rainy days comes. You see, Proverbs warns against giving in to the temptation of laziness. And this does not mean we should never rest. God gave the Jews, the Israelites, the Sabbath, a weekly day of rest and rejuvenation and restoration. You see, there's an overlooked passage of Scripture, and it is found in 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 10b. It says, if anyone will not work, neither shall he eat. Probably those who are not working but receiving pension is an exemption. They don't work, they just eat. I like that. That's your privilege because you work hard. Probably in the past 40 years in your life, You save so much in your social security and you just enjoy that. You don't work anymore. Just enjoy the blessing of your labor. Praise God. But the Apostle Paul is telling us who are still, you know, working, if we don't do that, if we don't work, then we are not supposed to eat. Wow, it's a very stern warning. God does not expect us to be lazy. That is what wisdom is telling us. But instead requires us to be diligent about the work He has given us to do. All right? And all of us, we have God-given things to do. And God is not just talking about your profession, your career, your livelihood. In the olden times, your field, your farm. No. He's talking about the work that He has given you and me. Okay? And so that is in one package there. Is that you cannot separate your career and your ministry, because wherever you work, that's your ministry. Amen? Wherever you are, that's where God planted you. And so you bloom there. You let God use you there. And God does not expect us to be lazy in doing what He wanted us to do. And this is what He said in Colossians chapter 3, verse 23 to 24 in the New King James Version. Whatever you do, do it heartily. Ministry or career or livelihood, whatever it is, He said, whatever you do, do it heartily. Do it with a heart, as to the Lord and not to men. It's like the ants. They don't have a commander to please, but they work. They do what they need to do. And that is exactly what wisdom, even God telling us, and whatever you do, do it heartily as to the Lord and not to men, knowing that from the Lord you will receive the reward of the inheritance, for you serve the Lord Christ. Whatever we do, we are actually serving Christ. As a child of God. When you know that you're a child of God, and whatever you do at home, at play, you know, in the marketplace, in those cubicles where you are in the classrooms where you are in, you are actually serving Christ. Wisdom tells us, go to the end. If you want to learn something and become wise, they have no leaders. They have no administrators, no governors, no rulers. But they prepare its provisions for their daily needs. Briefly, three things that we can get a lot there from that passage. But three important things I would like us to consider here. The ant teaches us at least three things. Number one, it teaches us priorities. The ant knows what needs to be done. They know. I don't know if they have brains. But they know what they need to do every day, and that is gather food. And probably you would say, that's all they do, and that's all they know what to do. All right? Priorities. The ant knows what needs to be done. The ant teaches us time management. And this is what wisdom would like us to understand here. That even the ant knows when things should be done. Remember, we're talking about the pitfalls of undisciplined. If you don't know your priorities and you don't know how to manage your time, then you are probably be falling into the pit of trouble. Know your priorities. Know what needs to be done. You can do a lot of things, and at the end of the day, you can be so tired about doing a lot of things and yet realize that you have not done what is important. That actually happened to me many times. At the end of the day, I realize that I've done a lot of stuff, but I have not done one thing that is really important in the Lord. I failed to do it. Know your priorities. Number two, manage your time. The ant knows when things should be done. When do you pray? When do you go to church and worship? When do you read your Bible? When do you nap? When do you drink your coffee? When do you go to work? When do you rest? Proper time management. Imagine even that we can learn it from the ant. They know when things should be done. Before the rain comes, let's do it. Let's gather food, because when rainy days comes, then we cannot go out and gather them. They know how to manage their time. They have no ruler. Nobody tells them what to do and when to do it and where to find it. But they know. And then number three is motivation. The ant knows why things need to be done. I guess they are really motivated because they don't stop. Amen? They don't stop. In fact, I challenge you. You go home. If you can find some ants, find if there are ants sleeping. They are working. All right? The ant knows why things need to be done. They know that if we don't do this, we will die tomorrow. And the truth that I can get from this, listen to this. From the ant, we learn to plan and work for the future without the constant need for immediate gratification. Sometimes our motivation is that we do things because instantly we can get, you know, the instant gratification, meaning the granting of what you want, and then you feel satisfied about it. Our motivation is very fleshly many times. Napoleon Hill, one of great, you know, speaker that I've read about, he said this: all great achievements start with great desire. Any achievement that you can achieve in life, say, naturally comes from a desire to get it. And at the same time, spiritually, greatest achievement in your spiritual life start with your great desire to know God. Great desire to serve God. I look up the word lazy in the dictionary, and it says laziness is disinclination to action or disinclined to exertion. It is adverse to labor, idle, slothful. I look at the word slothful, comes from the root word sloth. A sloth is an animal. It's like a snail that crawls to a dirty wall close to a canal or a dirty, you know, sewage. And this is a kind of snail that has no shell. And how they climb is they roll. They don't stand, they don't walk. They roll. That is the picture of a lazy man. Can't even stand. They just roll. No shell, meaning no backbone. Does it look good? Listen to this. We normally view laziness from a purely physical aspect regarding someone who won't work. That is just one aspect of laziness. Just as God calls for diligence and zeal in a number of areas of work, but He also encouraged us and wanted us to be diligent in our spiritual life. Actually, the greatest lesson here that I could see is the spiritual lesson that God wanted us to learn. Because I don't think so that many of us here, you know, needs more encouragement to work. Because even without encouragement, you really want to work. because there are bills to pay. There are friends and family to support. We have a lot of obligations. And that is enough motivation to work. But God is also, though that's important, is also reminding us even about laziness in the spiritual aspect of life. God calls us towards diligence and zeal in our spiritual life. In this case, laziness describes the failure to exercise a conscious effort to move ahead in your growth as a Christian. And God don't want us to find us like a sloth that just rolls and no direction at all. Come what may. Such a failure is actually what we call backsliding or sliding backwards in your Christian life. So the writer to the Hebrews lamented, actually, the fact that he could no longer address many of the deeper concepts of the spiritual world because they had become dull of hearing. The writer of Hebrews said, I cannot address you anymore as adult, as, you know, as grown up. He was talking about God's people because instead of advancing forward in their spiritual life, they become dull. That means they were once able but now no longer able to deal with the meatier issues of God's word. In fact, the writer of Hebrews said, you're supposed to be teachers right now, but you are still in the elementary. It's like you'd been, he's saying, it's like you'd been 30, 20 years in the church, in your Bible study, you are still childish. That's what the writer of Hebrews said. He said, they should have been teachers by now. In other words, we should have been teachers by now. We should have been in the ministry by now. That's what he's trying to say. But instead, we need to return to kindergarten. They should have been feasting in the porterhouse or the Wagyu or the New York steak sirloin, but now could only handle clam chowder. You see the comparison there? The analogy? Hebrews is saying, you're supposed to enjoy the meat now, but no. You are still elementary. Instead of advancing, and he was talking about the laziness. Their minds become dull and their lives becomes dull. They become disengaged and disinterested in the spiritual matters. They were so sucked in by the world, by the culture of the world, that they slide back. Spiritual laziness is described as a disengaged, less interested attitude toward the things of God. That's not my time yet. I think, yeah, it's just 12:08. As a pastor for at least 32 years now, I've observed a phenomenon among the Christendom, among the Christian. This is a phenomenon. Let's change the word phenomenon. Not phenomenon. It's a pandemic. So you can really get it. It's not a phenomenon. There's a pandemic that's going on among the Christian, among in the church of Jesus Christ right now. It is in the height of spiritual contradictions. I have seen people who are so diligent in work. They're diligent in working, It could be yard, it could be in the hospital, it could be in the school, it could be in the business. I've seen people, I'm not just talking about here, but all over the world, I've seen and I've observed people, and even pastors telling me about their people. They are so diligent in work. They're so diligent in maintaining their health. They're so diligent in providing for their family, but there's nothing to keep themselves spiritually healthy. In Tagalog, could be mataba physically, pero payat spiritually. You get my point? Or very muscled physically, but spiritually, no. Kunting ganun lang, tumba na. Kunting trial lang, wala na. Small temptation, kuha na. That's the pandemic that's going on. And you know, what's the pitfall? Why many Christians, many of our brothers and sisters, you know, are sliding backwards in their Christian life? The very reason wisdom is telling us here, laziness. Let me tell you this, we are in the same boat. I'm not pounding this just on you. I am also preaching on myself. Because there are times that I give in to the temptation of laziness. We thought temptations are just, you know, adultery, women, men, you know, money, fame, or whatever. No. Even laziness can be a temptation that would lead us into trouble. Amen? Not just materially, naturally, but even spiritually. When we are lazy to engage in the Word of God and in the spiritual things and stop doing the things that we love to do spiritually or in contribution for the kingdom of God. If we stop doing that, you slide back into sluggardness and laziness in your spiritual life and bring you into deep trouble of your spiritual life. Who would save us in this predicament? Listen to this. Remember that the goal for every follower of Christ, our ultimate goal, is to become rich. Remember this, Christians. Your ultimate goal in life is to become rich. Can I hear an amen? You don't say amen? To be rich in God. Akala niyo to be rich in money. That's why you're silent. The ultimate goal for every follower of Jesus Christ is to become rich in the things of God. Is to be rich towards God. Just as probably, you know, you work every day, you work hard because you want a good future and a bountiful future. There's nothing wrong with that. Okay? But wisdom is telling us balance. Remember, you are not just a physical person. You are a spiritual person. Amen? You are a spiritual person. You are not just a natural man. But you have the inner man. You have Jesus, you have the Holy Spirit living in you. You are spiritual. And your goal is to become rich towards the things about God. And the rich towards God, I believe, is that you and I has to be rich. That refers to being vibrant and living and personal and deep and satisfying relationship with Jesus Christ. Being rich towards God, does that mean you do a lot of works in the church? That's not advisable. You will get weary of doing that. Being rich towards God is to have the vibrant and living relationship and excitement in worship and reading God's word. And when you read God's word, it's like you are like you are sipping your Slurpee. You really enjoy it. That's rich towards God. That when you are asked to volunteer, that when you are asked to witness, when you are asked to go mission, when you are asked to give, when you are asked to lead or whatever, to do something for the Lord, you're ready to go. You're not lazy. Because you want your spiritual life to grow. Amen. And wisdom is telling us, don't fall into that pit of the undisciplined. Discipline your life to becoming rich towards God. Amen. Hallelujah. Remember that what we have is God's gift to us. What we have and what we become is our gift towards God. Next slide. A thought that I would like us to think. Now, before that, is there something before that, Sam? Before that slide, what was that? In other words, we must be the most diligent in taking initiative to keep a vital spiritual life. We must be the most diligent in taking initiative to keep a vital spiritual life. We have Hebrews chapter 6, verse 10 there. Do we have it? Listen to this. For God is not unfair. He will not forget how hard you have worked for Him. Okay? And how you have shown your love to Him by caring for the Christians, as you still do. Our great desire is that you will keep right on loving others as long as life lasts, in order to make certain that what you hope for will come true. Then you will not become spiritually dull or slothful or lazy and indifferent. Instead, you will follow the example of those who are going to inherit God's promises because of their faith and patience. God is not unfair. He will reward you in due time when you become diligent in the things of the Lord. Lastly, last part here. Don't fall into the pit of following the perverse motives of the heart. The Bible always speaks about the heart being deceitful. Though the heart is the center of our being, but when the heart is not surrendered to God, when the heart is not renewed, it is the source of all evil. And this is the example of a perverse heart. Verse 12, a worthless person. Worthless. Even how rich you are, even how known you are, how famous you are, how strong you are, when your heart is not right with God, you are worthless. The Bible says, I'm not making that up, wicked. And your mouth is perverse. They just curse and so proud about what they have and all that. Their actions, it talks about it. Verse 13, he winks with his eyes. So be careful when you wink. Okay. When he winks with his eyes, so wink with your what? Elbow? He winks with your eyes. He shuffles his feet. He points with his fingers. Oh, that's good. Because we Filipinos points with our mouth. We're safe. A wicked man points with his fingers. Perversity is in his heart. He devises evil continually. He sows discord. Therefore, his calamity shall come suddenly. Suddenly, he shall be broken without remedy. That's the destiny of a wicked person. This is a portrait of the man who is not to be trusted. And then, following verse, next slide, verse 6, 16 to 19, look at this. these six things the Lord hates. And then he talks about what God really hates. Six things, even seven. Completeness, meaning this is not just six, but seven, he said. What did he say? Abomination to him, a proud look, a lying tongue. It's like he repeats himself, right? Hands that shed innocent blood, a heart that devises wicked plans, feet that are swift in running to evil, a false witness who speaks lies, and one who sows discord among the brethren. Wow. Here the Bible is showing that all of the wicked man's gestures are controlled by the motives of the heart. Two Sundays ago, we were talking about be careful with your heart, right? A person can give you praise, yet is plotting wickedness against you. Be careful of people that might treat you, you know, differently, but behind your back might do something that you don't like. They can wink at you with their eyes, yet they could have hatred in their hearts. They can pat you on the back, but keep an eye on your back, for at some point, the hand that pats you on the back may contain a knife. Jesus experienced this. Judas. This is a man who cannot be trusted. The most wicked men are those who give all appearances of helping you, yet they are out there, their own selfish desires, and will hurt anyone who gets in the way. Example, human trafficking. That's the trend of the day. You don't hear that so much in you know, mainstream media. But if you listen to a lot of like just small news outlets, don't have enough money to make it really big, you can find this news about human trafficking that's going on. The exploitation of children. And they come to the kids with, you know, with all these promises and all that. They care for them, that, you know, we'll feed you, we'll, you know, put you in a beautiful house and all that. They speak to you with good candy-coated words, and then, you know, they will sell you somebody else. And the Bible says God's judgments are always just and sure. And so let us make sure that we are not the ones walking the path of the wicked man. Here's the warning here. Now, let me close with this. If there's seven things that God hates, I believe there's also seven things that God loves. So let's close, let's end this in the positive tone. All right? Listen to this. Seven things that God hates, but there are seven things that God loves also. A person who is humble. Now, it's just a reverse of that. Just reverse that. A person who is humble, a person that speaks the truth, a person who lifts up the innocent, a person who makes plans to do good instead of evil, a person who takes advantage of every opportunity to be godly in all our responses and actions, a person who is always truthful, witness, a person who seeks to build unity without compromising the truth. If there are seven things that God hates, I think if you reverse that, that's the seven things that God loves. Amen? And that's what wisdom is telling us. You notice that that's seven things that God loves, that is a picture actually of Jesus Christ. Right? That's a picture of Jesus Christ. He's humble, speaks what's true. He lifts up the innocent, the poor, the helpless. He doesn't plan what's bad, but always good. He takes advantage of every opportunity to preach the gospel. He's always truthful, witness. He seeks to build unity without compromising the gospel, without compromising the truth. The Apostle Paul said this in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 1. The Apostle Paul said this, "Imitate me, just I also imitate Christ." Wisdom is telling us, look at the end. Look at Christ. We don't have to look at who's trendy in Hollywood right now. We don't have to look up who our best or favorite actor, actress is, or model is. We are not asked to imitate the world or imitate anybody in the world, but we are asked to imitate Christ. Amen? We will never run out of somebody to copy because Jesus is always here. He's always true. I would like to ask the team to come, and we will sing that song, Lord, I Need You. And as they come, let me ask you this question. All right. How do you feel about this message today? How do you feel about it? Do you sense the Holy Spirit telling you something about any area of your life? Could be your relationships, could be your work, could be your family, could be your health, could be your money. How about your spiritual life? Do you sense the Holy Spirit's tugging, conviction about being engaged in the things of the Lord? And instead of slipping away about the things of the world, and you know, people have a lot of excuses today. But God's word is always true. It does not compromise to any culture or situation. It's always true. Remember this, that God loves us, God loves you. And when God tells you something that needs to be changed, He does it because God loves you. Amen. You out there watching us online, I'm also speaking to you. God would like to let you know that God loves you. And when He tells you to do something that needs to be changed, He does it because God loves you. God don't want you to fall into the pit. Do you feel you're rusting spiritually? Do you feel like you are going farther away from God instead of moving towards God? And this could be the day, this could be the time where you just come to the Lord just as you are and rededicate your life. God is gracious. He is gracious. He is merciful. And we can come to Him and say, God, forgive me. I have slipped away. I believe God understands when we are just honest before Him. When we tell Him, God, forgive me. I slipped away because I tried to manage my own life and I failed. I tried to control my own relationship, but I failed. I tried to control my own finances, but I failed. I tried to just do what I can do for myself, and it seems like it's not enough. Tried my best, but my best is never enough. What you actually need is to let Jesus be the center of your life. What you need to do is surrender your life to God, surrender your life to Jesus, and say, God, Lord, I'm slipping away. To come back to you. Help me, Lord, to love the things about you. Help me, Lord, not to be lazy about the spiritual things in my daily prayer and devotion and worship. worship, in my giving, in my supporting, in my serving. Lord, help me not to be lazy. Help me, Lord, to be engaged always. Now, your motivation should not be, I do this, Lord, so that you will bless me. No, that's a wrong thinking. You do it because the Lord has already blessed you. Amen. The Lord has already blessed you. The Lord has given you enough. And you may be asking, what is that, Pastor? He has given His Son, Jesus Christ, to you. All you need to do is just to give back to Him. And let Him work. Let Him work mightily in your life. Sometimes you don't feel it. Sometimes you don't see it. But He is working. Amen? He is working. And so we'll sing as we close. We will sing, Lord, I need you, because we need Jesus. Amen? Let's all stand. Let's sing this song with the team. Lord, I need you. Raise our hand and say, Lord, I need you.
Lord, I need you.
Lives for Jesus this week. This week's gonna be, I know, challenging again, but I believe it's an exciting week because the Lord will use us in many ways. Amen. I would like to welcome some of our guests. We have Dada there. Welcome from Reno, Nevada. Tony and Daisy, welcome. And some of you probably first time to come back. Joy, first time to come back since the lockdown. And yeah, just for 7 months, I forgot Jam. Welcome back, the Thomas family. Welcome back. All right. So, by the way, let's continue to support, continue to give what belongs to the Lord. So, we have a box there on the table. Just drop in the box your tithe and offering on your way back. And also online, we have it there, the way you can give online. So, thank you so much for continually supporting the ministry that the Lord has given us in this part of the world. And you are truly a blessing to this church. Amen. Let's give Jesus a clap offering. He's good. Let me dismiss you with a word of prayer. Father, thank you for this wonderful time of worship and fellowship and learning from your word. Thank you for how you will leave an imprint in our hearts of your righteousness, of your goodness, of your wisdom. That Lord, as we live daily our lives, let it be, God, that we are doing all for your glory, for your honor. Thank you, God, for your goodness. And thank you, God, for another week that we will be having. God, it's a blessing from you. And Lord, we just want to commit our lives to you and say that we need you, Lord, every day. We need your guidance. We need your wisdom. We need your protection. We need your provision. We need your covering, God. And that, Lord, you use us for your glory and for your honor. Lord, I pray that you bless every family represented here and every family out there, the VICC families. I pray, God, that your goodness and your favor will follow them, Lord, every day in their lives as they continue to seek you and serve you. Thank you, God. We give you glory and praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Thank you so much. Good afternoon, everyone. God bless you all. Go Cardinals.